Hey guys, welcome to another screencast. So what I want to do now is to kind of introduce you to a new PaaS system, sort of like a new kid in the block. It's called Openshift, and Openshift is a PaaS project by the renowned Red Hat guys, and they've really done a very great job so far. They've made it also available into the hands of community members to play around with, to hack and kind of contribute code and kind of make it better. Now, just like with everything Red Hat being the leader in open source, they've kind of pushed the enterprise and making it making it open, sort of like an open model where you kind of see exactly what they do, the kind of codes they contribute to the project, and they kind of make it stable in an upstream fashion and kind of give you support on that. So OpenShift, basically, like I said, is a platform as a service system, and Red Hat has actually created three versions of PaaS, of the OpenShift PaaS, and you can see here on their webpage, openshift.com. The first one is the online edition, or the online version. The online version is geared towards the public cloud. So basically, you can go ahead and kind of host your plans and kind of pay for more services, if you will. And you can check more about that. You can even sign up for a free account. They can give you 3 gears, and of course, you can play around with and see how this works for you. Now, the next one here is the enterprise version, which is basically geared towards private PaaS. This is for enterprise organizations who want to have a PaaS for in-build development, application development, and their developers. Basically, a kind of a bridge between the, you know, the traditional enterprise level organization and, of course, the cloud, basically. So if you're kind of evaluating a PaaS system for your enterprise, I'll recommend you check out the enterprise version of OpenShift. And the community edition, which is the origin, basically OpenShift origin is the exact same thing you have in enterprise and online, because this is where the main innovation happens. So if you're familiar with Fedora or any kind of the pet projects that Red Hat is working on, basically you know by now that they kind of put their effort in the community edition, allow the community to also contribute, and once they feel it has gotten to a stage that is mature a bit, they can bring in the engineers to kind of solidify all the loose ends and kind of give you support on that and make it an enterprise edition. All right, so basically we're going to be using the origin edition of OpenShift. So basically over the next couple of minutes, I will be talking about the general, basically OpenShift origin in general. You can read more about OpenShift here. You can check out the new announcement they made in their summit, which is the XPaaS, basically middleware and OpenShift. So you can check that and see what they have in stock for you. And of course, on the next tab, I have how OpenShift works and how it ties together. So OpenShift basically will have some few terminologies that is peculiar to OpenShift. Basically, PaaS is a general term for platform as a service. So basically, your PaaS is made of all the infrastructure, your nodes and your brokers, and of course the virtualization technology you're using underneath that. Of course, you have the operating system here. So you run RHEL. RHEL is basically, you can see the red highlight here. Basically, the Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So basically, your PaaS implementation has to rely on a very stable operating system. In this case, RHEL. For our own demo sakes and for this lab I have here, basically went ahead and used CentOS. So CentOS, basically, you know that it's sort of like a rebuilt version of Red Hat Enterprise Linux. All right, so now you're talking about the infrastructure. The infrastructure here is basically the kind of technology we're using to serve up the nodes, basically the operating system. So you can use bare metal implementation here from your physical servers, or you can use virtualized technologies. In this case, where I'm using VMware for my lab, so basically I'm going via the virtualization route, or you can kind of have a private cloud infrastructure or a public cloud. Basically, the infrastructure is totally up to you and your kind of deployment use case. Now, OpenShift has what it calls a node, and basically a node is basically where your application If I hover there, you can see where user applications reside. So basically, if you create a PHP application, for instance, it resides, it kind of creates a gear on one of the nodes, and of course the node will house the application and all your application code. Now OpenShift has what's called a broker. So a broker is sort of like the control engine, sort of like the controller, if you will. Basically this kind of creates all the scheduling and how to kind of talk to each of the nodes, how to provision a particular cartridge, and of course notifies the nodes that are available. So for instance, you understand at some point in our screencast, series of screencasts, that OpenShift uses something called a district. So basically a district is a way of separating all your nodes into kind of chunks, and you will see a reason why that is so. The UUID limitation on the implementation of OpenShift. So broker, as you can see, multiple nodes are managed by the OpenShift broker that serves as a pass management engine. So as you can see here, it's the main control system for coordinating orchestration and automation of your application deployment. Now gears, as you can see, this is the whole node that we have, and gears are basically containers for your application. And what OpenShift does is OpenShift uses the C group's container technology to kind of isolate each and every node, make it available only to a single tenant. So you can see here, OpenShift node is a multi-tenant environment for end user applications. So OpenShift gears are secure containers where applications run within your OpenShift node. So basically, if you create a PHP application, your application will reside in a gear, and the gear will contain your application code. Of course, what does the isolation and the magic, of course, is SELinux. So you can see SELinux, of course, provides a pre-configured and hardened security layer around the gear. So for instance, gear that belongs to one tenant will not be accessible to another tenant from using another gear, of course. So everything is properly isolated using SELinux. And of course, C groups, like I mentioned, of course, C groups or the control groups, Linux subsystem to allocate compute resources. So C group basically is one in charge of saying, okay, you're going to have a gear for, a small gear that has 1 gig of RAM, or that has 512 MB of RAM and 1 gig of storage. And of course, as you can see, of course, gives you all the CPU capacities and the disk capacities for your gears. So basically, C groups, SELinux, and your gears basically are what makes up the node, basically. So in this case, if you're installing, if you're setting up a node, this is basically, you have to provide a high performance system for that, because I mean, this is what we'll be doing a lot of the computing, of course, the disk storage, and of course, a whole lot of providing gears for you. Now, under the high density here, you can see OpenShift gear quantization model enables high density with security. So for instance, here you can see on this node, I can have as much nodes as possible. Of course, you can see I have multiple gears on each node. So it depends on the offering you're providing for your users. For instance, if you're going to give them a large profile, a gear profile, then of course you want to make sure that it matches with your hardware specification or your VM in this case. All right, so hopefully that made sense. You can spend some time here and read more about this. This is me trying to kind of give you OpenShift in a nutshell and how it works, of course. So I'm going to jump over to kind of what I have already. I just have a bare installation of OpenShift. What I did actually behind the scenes, instead of waiting for the installation to complete, it actually took a while for me to install. Of course, it will depend on your internet connection and kind of technology you're using to serve this. In this case, I'm using a VM infrastructure, so it took a while. But I'm just going to kind of walk you through an overview of what I did and how to kind of what I used to install that. And I used the OO installer. As you can see, the OO installer is documented on the OpenShift GitHub page. Basically, I followed some kind of the documentation here, which I suggest you do. Basically, the documentation walks you through everything. I started out with a kind of I use CentOS, like I mentioned, CentOS 6.5. So I started with a minimal installation of CentOS, basically nothing apart from what makes it come up after the installation. And what I did was I kind of installed Ruby. So basically, I ran this command on each of the nodes that is on the machine here. So after running it on each of the node here, you can see that they've kind of created a separation between what your target hosts are. So your target host could be the machine you're trying to set up as a node, of course your broker, And then after that, of course, ensure you have SELinux. So of course, once you install the minimal installation, it comes with SELinux defaulting to enforcing mode, which is basically what we need, because as you can see here, SELinux must be running in enforcing or permissive mode. All right, so now on all target hosts, basically including the this means it's including both the broker and the node host, make sure you have Puppet installed and AUG tool. So in CentOS, basically this is not correct. So the documentation here refers to Ubuntu. If you're using CentOS, you want to use the AUGAS command. So I'm just going to open a new notepad and kind of copy the command that you're going to use. So this is just to provide guidance, if you will. Right, so you're going to install the AUGS application on CentOS. So I think it's available when you have the EPL repository enabled, so I'm not sure, but I think I had what I did was, before even doing any of the installations, I had to jump to this step here to install the EPL YUM repository. So you can follow the steps here, you download the repository and you know, kind of install it. But what I did was I could actually install it all in one line. So I did, all right, so I did something like this. Instead of the wget, I just installed the directory. So yum install, basically. So this went ahead and installed the copy of EPL from the EPL repository. And once I did that, I copied this command here, which basically creates a YUM repository. A definition of you know, creates the OpenShift origin devs repo, and of course points it to the OpenShift mirror.openshift.com public repository. So here it's using the nightly and using the rel 6 dependency. So this will be used to install multiple dependencies, as you can see behind the scenes anyway, once you're installing your copy of OpenShift origin. So after doing that, then I went ahead and installed Ruby, I installed unzip curl AUGS, and I'm just going to be writing some of them here. So I installed the SCL or software collection version of Ruby, which provides Ruby 1.9.3 on CentOS and RHEL. Alright, so as you can see here, and of course, you know, part of the requirements on the broker host, what I did was I installed bind. Bind was what provided the DNSSEC keygen tool. So I went ahead on the broker. So I'm just going to duplicate this line and I'll say all hosts. And basically on the broker, I had to install additional tools. So in this case, I had to install the as to install bind. This will be used by DNS, but in my installation, as you've seen other subsequent screencasts, I'm going to swap out I'm going to remove the ability for the broker to use its inbuilt bind DNS for applications and point it to an existing DNS server that I have. So stay tuned. And of course, the HTTP passwd on the broker is needed. Basically, if you're using the kind of basic installation on the HTTP basic authentication type, which is by default on OpenShift. All right, so if you're wondering how to install this, I got it from the HTTPD tools package. So this provided the HTTP passwd tool. All right, so after doing all this, of course, and after installing the dependencies, of course, I made sure that every other thing that was mentioned here was installed, and I head over to the page. Of course, you can just run this to run the installer on the online version. But what I did was I went ahead and took the OpenShift Origin Portable installer. Since I'm installing Origin, I'm not installing Enterprise. But if you're installing Enterprise, then feel free to use this version of the installer. So I downloaded. So basically what I did was I downloaded the installer on my broker. So using wget, I downloaded the installer, and as soon as I downloaded the installer, I unzipped it. So basically I unzipped the whole install origin.zip file and I created a directory called installer. So it extracted it into an installer directory. And the moment I did that, all I had to do was basically go into the installer directory, and there I have to run the OO install command. Now there are two ways of running the OO install command. Basically you can use the dash A, or you can see documentation here as well. You can see dash A here that allows you to provide an advanced mode. So if you're going to do a kind of you're going to separate all the components that make the OpenShift origin installation, like the messaging system, like the database server, then you can go ahead and use the dash A option, which allows you to provide kind of more configuration for your messaging server and of course your storage or DB server. So basically for the database server it uses MongoDB, and for the messaging it uses the ActiveMQ implementation for that. And of course basically by now you should know that since I'm referring to broker nodes, OpenShift refers to them as different roles. So you can have different machines provide different roles for your implementation of OpenShift. Now, one thing I also did during the installation, I'll show you in a moment, was I went ahead and built the recent version of the RFPMs on the OpenShift website, that's the GitHub page for the OpenShift website. So of course you can check out that, you can check this guide basically to see how to create a development environment and build the RPMs for use on your own case. So for me, I wanted to install the latest versions of the RPMs with all the latest changes and what's going on in the OpenShift repo and GitHub. So I built the RPMs here and I pointed it to my website basically. So what I do is I usually use it for my installation and my lab needs, and of course if I need to create a custom kind of implementation for some clients. All right, so basically what this does, of course you can read through and create the documentation, but for me I think I've already done that. So I'm just going to go ahead and show you quickly, because I already have an answer file here. So I'm going to go into an OpenShift directory here, and I already have an OO install cfg.yaml file. So once you run the installer the first time, it creates this file so that subsequently you can read from this file and try to serve you with what you've already created before. So in this case, you can see what I did was the OS optional repo. You can see I pointed it to a repository running on my site. This is because I already have I kind of created the RPMs for the latest version of the RPMs for the OpenShift installation. The Jenkins base URL is the same as the Jenkins, the default that you get. I provided an OS repo pointing to the CentOS 6.5 x86-64 repo. And the base repo is basically the OpenShift release 6, basically. And the subscription type here is the YUM type. And for other things here, you can see the installer configuration here. For DNS, we're using the app.mao.local. I already have this DNS DNS infrastructure running, which you'll see in other screencasts as we kind of point the broker installation to the already existing DNS infrastructure. And of course, I've already told it to register the hosts on the same DNS domain as the app. And of course, the component domain here is the mao.local. As for host, basically the host will name the IP address. In this case, the DNS address here, we need to point to the DNS address of my existing DNS infrastructure. And the IP address for the broker here, as you can see, the 120, and the user I'm using here is root. And the host name basically is broker.node, broker.node.mao.local. And one thing you want to also ensure you've done basically is make sure this name's resolved, right? So basically, if you don't have a DNS infrastructure like I do in this case, please make sure you add it to your etc host file, just so that it can actually reach all the hosts. And you want to make sure you set up passwordless connection between from your installer host. So in this case, your installer host doesn't have to be the broker host. Basically, it can be a laptop, it can be anything. But basically, in this case, I downloaded the installer on the broker host. So there was an SSH passwordless connection, SSH connection between the broker and the node, and vice versa. All right, that was needed so that you can actually, the Puppet configuration tool can go ahead and kind of go into the box and provision the box remotely. Now, for the host, in this case, for the broker, I'm using the local host, so it doesn't have to connect remotely. And the state here is new. This simply means that we're doing a new installation of OpenShift. And the IP address here is connected to the interface here is etc/etc/2. And of course, the roles for the broker in this case is going to be, you know, it's going to be the same message. It's going to be the one providing the messaging server. It's going to be the one providing the DB server, and of course, it's going to be the broker. So this is what I was referring to as roles earlier on the page. So let me just quickly take you there. Role summarize. So you can see you have a broker, you have the DB server, you have the message server, and of course, you have the node. So the node in this case, where I'm using a different box this way, so that we can actually kind of see how these things ties together. And of course, you can create a very, very kind of decoupled implementation so that you can kind of create a highly available infrastructure, if you will, later in the future. All right, so the next thing here is an IP address for the host, and same thing applies, the user and the host. So because I already have a DNS implementation, like I mentioned before, this host will resolve, the host names will resolve to their corresponding IP addresses. But if you don't, please make sure you create an etc, entering the etc host file. And of course here, because we are using connecting from the broker to this box, we're going to use the, you know, instead of the SSH host, in this case being local, it's going to be remotely at 1.1.21. And of course, it's still going to be a new installation and the etc2 interface as well. And the role in this case is going to be the node role. All right, so yeah, that's what I did. And if you're wondering, let me just quickly walk you through. Right. So yeah, so if I press 1, you can see that the configuration has been read successfully here. You can see my broker is going to be on the broker node, and my node is going to be here. And you can see all the options that I explained earlier. You can see them in this tabular form. Of course, if you want to modify any of the entries here, of course, you can go ahead and do that. So in this case, I don't want to modify that. And the next thing here is the subscription, like I mentioned before, provided an optional repository for the OS. Basically, this is just an optional repo for me that points to my packages. So what happens is, if it tries to install the application, my repo has the latest version, so it's going to go ahead and update, install the newer version, of course, as opposed to the old version that is in the release package. All right, so I'm now going to go ahead and run this. So just going to go ahead and cancel this. I already have it installed, basically. So hopefully this made sense. Of course, my node host basically is already up. So in the next set of screencast, I'm going to show you how what I will do, basically setting it up to look like what I had previously. And you know, the idea is to show you my experiences, you know, kind of bugs and how I fixed it, and basically what to do if some things don't just work for you. All right, so hopefully this made sense, and hopefully you liked the overview. I'm sorry that I didn't really show you the steps in details of installing all these components. This is because it took a while for me, and I don't want to kind of give you a very long video on just how to wait for the installation of that. So if you have any comments, suggestions, please drop them in the forums below, and we'll get back to you, and hopefully we will discuss stuff and how to make it better in the future. Thanks a lot.